Welcome to Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church, and thank you for being a part of our television ministry. Pulaski Heights is a place of warmth and love, with an outreach mission that extends far beyond our church walls. We have a long tradition of offering our hearts, stretching our minds, and extending Christ's hands to those in need. We are a congregation of hope and an open place of worship that seeks to share the good news beyond the conventional barriers of fellowship.
Hi, I'm Brent Scarta, Senior Pastor at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. It is our desire that you will be inspired by today's message of hope for a diverse community in search of God's love.
Please join in our prayer of confession. God of the past, the present, and the future, you fulfill your promise to always be with us. Forgive us for ignoring your presence and not loving you with our whole heart. We confess we have denied your love and have not shared your love with others. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God will not fail to fulfill all the divine promises. God has promised to hear our prayers and forgive our sins. Then our prayers are heard and we are forgiven. We can begin again and live for God. Amen. As forgiven people, let us share the peace of Christ with those around us. Sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, please be seated. Through the sacrament of Christian baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church, and we are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. Brother Scarter, Bishop McKenzie, and members of Plaski Heights United Methodist Church, I present Hayden Grace and Jay Mackey Hamilton, Charlotte Ann Skirm for the sacrament of baptism. And now, John and Kyle, Samantha and Ernie, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please say I do. Do you accept the freedom God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, please say, I do. Will you nurture these children in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, please say, I will. Members of PHUMC, will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include these persons now before you in your care? If so, please say, we will.
We will.
All right. Hayden and Jay Mackey and Charlotte, we want to introduce you to your Christian family. So we're going to have everyone take a baby. And we want you to meet some pretty special people. This is the body of Christ. This is your family of faith. And so Hayden and Jay Mackey and Charlotte, you have been blessed to be a part of this faith community, and you are going to bless us in so many wonderful ways. It's a great congregation, and we will watch you grow up, and we will teach you the faith, and we will pray for you until you claim that faith for yourself. Aren't they beautiful and handsome, all of them? Yeah, they are. Wonderful. We're just delighted to welcome you on this special day. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on this gift of water and on these children who receive it. wash away their sin and clothe them that in righteousness, that by dying and being raised in you, they may be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Right. Hi, Hayden. How are you? You ready? Hayden Grace, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Holy Spirit work within you that been born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jay Mackey, you're going to sleep through this, so we'll remind you of it for years to come. Jay Mackey, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Holy Spirit work within you that been born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
You ready? All right. Let's see if I can untie this. Ah. You ready, Charlotte? Charlotte Ann, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Holy Spirit work within you to be born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Mm-hmm. Members of Flying Skies United Methodist Church, let us welcome the newly baptized as printed in your bulletin. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you into Christ's Holy Church. We are all one in Christ Jesus our Lord. We promise to love, encourage, nourish, and support you, and to help you know and follow Christ.
With you.
Let
us pray. Holy God, how good it is when our lives honor you. When brothers and sisters live together in unity, it's like oil of blessing pouring down, spilling out and running over, touching our hearts and overcoming hurts. How good it is when our love for you cannot be contained. When we love together in peace and unity, it's like fresh water bubbling up, spilling out and running over. How good it is when our love touches the lives of others. It's like a river bringing relief to parched land, spilling out and running over, breaking down barriers and inviting the thirsty in. Today, as your church, we lift up our Christian sympathy to Bryant Smith and family in the death of his father, Stephen Smith, to Jenny Anderson and family in the death of her father, Harold Young, to Sean Harper and family in the death of his father, Charlie Harper, to the family and friends of Ruth Windham in her recent death, and to Susan Hill and family in the death of her son, Robert R. Tankersley. We pray for those who have been hospitalized recently, Bobby Bonner, Phyllis McGrew, John Shermer, Steve Peterson, and Joe Knight. We rejoice in the recent birth of William Beckett Smith, child of Sayward and Bryant Smith. And we rejoice in the baptism of Hewitt May Hastings, child of Jillian and Grant Hastings, and of Landon Tate Moore, child of Michelle and Brad Moore. Lord, thank you for those who have become new members in our faith community, Brittany and Daniel Atkinson, Sarah Beth Edwards, Eric Engler, Dottie McLemore, and Virginia Smizer. Holy One, we thank you for bringing Bishop McKenzie our way this day to bless us and challenge us with your word. As brothers and sisters, may we hear what you have to say to us this day. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
In the fall of 2010, I attended a clergy convocation at Duke University. The preacher for that event was Bishop Vashti Murphy McKenzie. Oh my. From the moment Bishop McKenzie took to the pulpit, opened her mouth, and began to speak God's word, the gathered crowd was captivated. She delivered a powerful and convicting message that brought transformation. And in that moment, I had a dream. What if we could have Bishop McKenzie preach here at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church? Bishop McKenzie, a native of Baltimore, Maryland, is the 117th elected and consecrated bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Her election to the episcopacy in 2000 was historic for several reasons, not the least of which she was the first woman to hold this office in the history of the AME Church. Bishop McKenzie is currently serving as the presiding prelate of the 10th Episcopal District. She is the published author of best-selling books like Not Without a Struggle and Strength in the Struggle. She was recently named by Huffington Post as one of the 50 most powerful women religious leaders in the world. Bishop McKenzie has served as national chaplain for Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, and she is married to former NBA star Stan McKenzie, who is with us today as well. Welcome, Stan. Our appreciation, of course, is extended to the Rainey family for making Bishop McKenzie's presence with us possible. Since 1951, the Rainey Preaching Series has brought the finest preachers from around the world to this place, and we have been blessed. Our gratitude today is also extended to the Clinton Foundation for their support in this important effort. You will be blessed to hear Bishop Vashti McKenzie following the reading of the gospel.
You're invited to stand for the reading of the gospel, which is Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 6 in the New Testament. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
First, giving honor to God, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, to the senior pastor of this church, Reverend Scarter, to the members of the ministerial staff, to those who are providing leadership in our worship today, to the members of this congregation and to those who provide leadership in various ways, to my partner in life and ministry, Dr. Stan McKenzie, to the family, to the Rainey family, and to the Clinton Foundation for working this all out that we're able to share with you today. Our text has been lifted before you, and we simply ask in your time of devotion and prayer that you'll take a look again at verses 2 and 6. And our theme this morning is God Got This. And see, if I was at home, I would tell you to turn to your neighbor and say, God's got this. I said, if I was at home, I would tell you to say to your neighbor, God's got this. Very good. Pressure has become an ever-present accessory to living in the world we live in. It is a constant and consistent companion, like the goodness and mercy that the psalmist writes, which may follow us all the days of our lives. Pressure is something that we either live with or we live under. It is a natural gift of our human nature to help us either to push through something or to pull back. We either push through a difficulty or we pull back to safety. Push through a challenge or pull back because it is a threat. Pressure on its good day will help us to rally on the field of competition or on the field of battle. When athletes or teams with similar strengths and talents compete, it is often how they handle the pressure that can determine who wins and who goes home. On its good day, pressure will revive us. It'll keep us up on our toes. Pressure will make us stay on point, alert, clear, on the edge, and the adrenaline helps us to be ready for anything. That's on its good day. On its bad day, pressure can make even the strongest among us crumble under its weight, with its trinity of fear, doubt, and worry. On its bad day, pressure will cause you to worry about stuff that is not worth worrying about. Pay attention to the minutiae and minor, missing the big picture altogether. On its bad day, pressure can cause you to make mountains out of molehills, start fights without provocation, engage in road rage and fuss without a cause, push when you should pull back, pull when you should push, and you end up depleted of the energy that you really need to make it through the day. Every day brings new pressures you've never seen before. They're added to the pressures we already have. For pressure doesn't dissipate, it just relocates and just replicates itself in new and unique ways. There is the negative pressure that breaks you down and the positive pressure that pumps you up. There's the pressure that puts you into a challenged state or a state of emergency. No matter what type of pressure is going on, it affects your health. Pressure ruins your appetite. Say amen at any time. Pressure will rearrange your agenda. Pressure assigns migraine headaches as homework, pushes blood pressure up for fun, gives out heart attacks as door prizes, turn perfectly good brown, black, red, and blonde hair gray. Pressure creates worry lines in our faces and wreaks havoc with our immune system and has sent more than one person to an early grave. When what you pray for is different from what you get, that's pressure. When you carry the cross daily and you want the crown, pressure. When the expectations of others collide with your own expectations, pressure. In this 21st century of ours, we wrestle with daily pressures. What pressures? There is the pressure of perfection. We want to live perfect lives, have perfect families, have perfect children. There's no such thing. Perfect role models, perfect decorum, perfect wardrobe, perfect churches. There's no such thing. There is the pressure of originality, the expectation of doing more than thinking out of the box, but creating new boxes to think out of. Something that has never been seen before, done before, the pressure of originality. There is the pressure of relevance, serving God out of our own experiences under the power of the Holy Spirit, the present age, with the juice and hype of a millennial generation. There is the pressure of performance. You must be at the top of your game every day. There is the pressure of privacy. You have none. There is the pressure of our own humanity, which is subject to the same temptations and vulnerabilities as everybody else. And in case you think you are the first in humankind to ever have to wrestle with pressure, remember Moses was under pressure because of his murmuring congregation wanted to be free without the responsibility of freedom. Joseph was under pressure between his prophetic future and his present reality in the pit, in Potiphar's house, and in prison. Elijah was under pressure and ran from Ahab and Jezebel. Esther was under pressure between who she was and who she had become. So in our text, Cephas was under pressure because the lawyers that he sent to trick and trap this upstart by the name of Jesus were sent home in silence when he said, "If you have no sin, cast the first stone." The high priest was under pressure because spies told him that the crowd was calling Jesus the Messiah. But Jesus just did not fit this prophetic notion of the Messiah. He was just the carpenter's son out of Nazareth, where nothing good comes from. He's nothing like the triumphant king described by the prophets. So come with me now, and let's see how these several personalities responded to great stress and intense pressure. Each of them had pressures peculiar to their roles and responsibilities. One man was of the cloth, under pressure to maintain the ethical foundations of their sophisticated religious structure. Another was of the Roman guard, sworn to maintain a military presence of Caesar and to enforce the law of the ruling authorities. One was a temple insider, wise in the ways of political intrigue. And another was a temple outsider, wise in the ways of God. One was a member of the Jewish religious status quo, and the other had come not to destroy the law of the prophet, but to fulfill them. One was a set-aside protector, interpreter, and guardian of the law, and the other was the way and the truth and the light. One was big on rules, and the other was big on godliness. One was big on every jot and tittle, and the other was big on love, loving God, loving self, even loving your enemies. One was big on public displays, while the other was big on personal obedience. And then one was an open, admitted enemy, and another was a pretended friend. Luke, God's scientific physician who gives the details of the life and ministry of a universal Savior, now gives us a sparse glimpse into what happened the day before the Last Supper, the betrayal and the trial and the tragedy. Jesus, the only begotten of the Father, the Son of God, surely is feeling the pressure already. He has already glorified God through the strict obedience to his will. He had already allowed himself to suffer a carnal body. He had already given consent to yield to this plan of salvation. He had already administered God's grace through healing and miracles. He had already taught the 12 and giving them words of comfort in preparation for his departure and this new ministry. He was between the already and the not yet time that is on the way. Matthew tells us that Judas betrayed Jesus in order to make money. John says that Judas doesn't make money on the betrayal, but from pilfering from the common purse. Judas betrays Jesus to the chief priest before they offered money. But in Luke, Luke says the devil made him do it. Remember, this is the same Luke who told us that Satan had already showed up to tempt Jesus in the desert. Jesus confronted evil with it is written. The devil had a bent over woman, bent over for 12 years until Jesus placed his big hands on her and loosed her from this bondage. And Luke said that Satan had departed for a season. This evil present goes to work utilizing a member of the Lord's Amen Corner. Remember now that Jesus had handpicked his disciples, and they were members of an inner circle, and Judas was picked and now was picked out for the betrayal. Judas had to at least love Jesus at some time, somewhere along the way. And Judas goes to the chief priests and the officers of the temple to offer his service. Judas becomes the antagonist of all time. He is the villain. He is the fly in the ointment, the barrier, to ministry success. He is in cahoots with the other side of a difference opinion. He is hated and despised. And even today, what family names their son Judas? It wasn't just Judas who plotted and betrayed Jesus. Judas was also a tool in the hand of God so that while we were yet sinners, Jesus died for us. And so what shall we say to these things that may help us handle our own pressures? Understand that change doesn't happen without conflict. Amen. Conflict is a natural attribute to change that produces pressure. Not because we people do not want to change, but because we don't want to lose control. And everything about Jesus was about change. What Jesus said and how Jesus said it and how Jesus did it spoke about change. He reminded those who experienced power that they really didn't have power at all. And people who are in power don't like to be told they don't have any power at all. He reminded those who thought they had power that he had the last word. And here we are back again at our praise God moment because God has the last word in our lives. The doctor doesn't have the last word on your life. The lawyer does not have the last word on your life. The judge does not have the last word on your life. Your enemy, your friend, and your family does not have the last word on your life. God has the last word on your life. every time Jesus healed a sick person, rebuked the demon, calmed the storm, fed a multitude, Jesus was declaring that a new day was coming. What kind of new day? The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And that was good news for everybody, except for those in first place. Jesus didn't spend time kissing up to the Pharisees. He didn't spend time brown-nosing the Sadducees. He didn't spend any time sucking up to Pilate or Herod. There was another reason for his robing in the veil of human flesh, a cause for his divine intervention into the affairs of humankind. Jesus didn't come to make a name for himself, but pointed beyond himself to the Father. He was indifferent to the appearance and accolades of humankind. He said he didn't come to serve, to be served, but to serve. When you know who is in charge, changes how you think and feel and act. When you wake up in the morning and know that God's got this, it changes how we handle the pressures of our lives. When change comes, it forces conflict, but God is still large and in charge. And then no one can destroy what God intends to do. That's your second praise God moment. Beloved, understand that the betrayal and death of Christ was not determined in the back room of the temple, was not developed in the mind of Judas, but the Revelator declares that the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world before Adam fell, before sin entered into the human existence. Salvation from it had already been planned by God. In the divine counsel of the Godhead, it was foreordained that there would be a second Adam, a Savior who would suffer and die in order that we might live. The only begotten of the Father offered himself for ransom. Jesus said in that garden, when the question was asked, whom do you seek? The response was Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus then said, I am. I am he. The same I am. Heard from the burning bush, I am. Now comes forth out of the mouth of Jesus, I am. And it was reported that Judas fell back, and they went backwards and fell to the ground. They were in the presence of God. The incarnate Christ, whose majesty pushed through their plot. Jesus could have walked away. He could have delivered himself into their hands. Beloved, God is, and no one and nothing can destroy what God intends to happen in your life. That's your third praise God moment. I praise God for you. So the next time that you're under pressure, and pressure is trying to handle you, push you to destroy yourself or destroy someone else, remember, God's got this. God is still God. God still rules and God still reigns. God is still the deliverer and the justifier. God is still a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. God is still a sword and a shield. God is still our battle axe and our battle. God is still the glory and the lifter of our head. God is still present and a present help in time of need. Come on, James Cleveland, help me sing this song. God is the joy and the strength of my life. He moves all pain, misery, and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave me, never, never come short of his word. I've got to fast and pray and stay in the narrow way. I've got to keep my life clean every day. I've got to go with him when he comes back. I'll never, never turn back. Why? Because God is. When there is change, there is conflict, but God is. The Judases in life cannot abort what God intends to do. And then finally, we just have to get out of the way and let God have his way in our lives. God is working some stuff out. And has the thought ever crossed your mind that you just are getting in God's way? God is trying to move over here, and you over there trying to figure out how you can get over there before God gets over there. You're trying to think your way through. You're trying to manipulate and orchestrate people and things in your lives. And God is trying to tell you, hold up, stand still. I don't know who's in here today. I don't know who needs to hear it. But somebody needs to hear it this morning. Just stand still. Even when you're faced and you're under pressure with your enemies, when your enemies show up, this is the time that you praise God. But you don't understand, enemies have a role in their lives. Yes, they do. And when enemies show up, we just ought to say, thank God I'm on the right track. Because enemies never come if you're not doing anything at all. If you're not doing anything worthy and wonderful, if you're not a person of purpose, then enemies will go somewhere else. But the moment you get it all together, the moment you got a clear path forward, enemies will show up, and then you say, thank God, because I'm doing something wonderful. Wait. They also have a role and functionality in your life, because when the enemies show up, you're going to pay attention to what you do. You're going to pay attention to what you say, because if I walk into this room, my enemies are there, so I must be prepared. Your enemies will keep you on point. Your enemies will make you go back and read over it again. Your enemies will make you study. Your enemies will make sure that your presentation is perfect, because your enemies are going to ask questions. And they're going to try to block you and get in the way. And so right now, whisper a prayer and say, thank God for my enemies. That is just the, try that again. Whisper a prayer just a little bit louder and tell God, thank you for my enemies. For all the positive things they do in my life. Because this is a call to trust God. This is the moment where we are to trust the one who knows where we are and trust the one who already has tomorrow on the view screen of heaven. Trust means surrender your whole on the circumstances. It means letting go of your human solutions and allow God to step in. The same God who was in control in Luke's gospel is the same God who sits at the controls of your life today. God's ways are not our ways. Don't you remember that passage of scripture? And so, beloved, if you find yourself in a place this morning, you got your job back, but not your reputation, trust God. You got out of surgery, but you're not out of the woods, trust God. You're out of the frying pan and into the fire, trust God. You're out of debt, but you're still broke, trust God. Yeah, I say amen for you. Take a deep breath. Take your hands off the wheel. Let God drive the rest of the way home. When the pressure is on, faith will keep you in the race. When pressure sends you to your knees, pray. When pressure keeps you up at night, sing until the power of the Lord comes down. When pressure ruins your appetite, taste and see how good the Lord is. When pressure wrecks your health, allow God's peace to surpass all understanding. When pressure stresses you out, stretch out into the arms of Jesus. When your spirit is low, then allow the Lord's spirit to take you to higher heights. What do you do when it does not seem you can do anything at all? Then just stand still and see the glory of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop McKenzie. If you were blessed this morning by the message, say amen.
Amen.
As the ushers come forward to receive our offering, today is UMCOR Sunday, so please consider a generous gift towards aiding worldwide disaster relief through the United Methodist Committee on Relief, and envelopes you'll find it at your pew. Also, if you have not had the opportunity to make a commitment to the St. Luke Learning Center. You also have commitment cards that you can also put in the offering plates. Let us pray. Receive our gifts, offerings, for the mission of the church, for UMCOR, and for the St. Luke Learning Center for Children. Bless us to give generously from the depths of our hearts. Amen.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Please be seated. Holy are you, and blessed is Jesus Christ, On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord gathered in a place apart, and there at the table he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of my new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that in unity we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by Christ's blood. Through Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at your heavenly table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Now, with the confidence of God's children, we are bold to pray the prayer he taught, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Today, we gather around the table as one people, as the body of Christ. And we invite you to receive this sacrament, all of you. In our United Methodist tradition, the table is open to all because Christ is the host and Christ welcomes all. There are six stations for receiving communion. By intinction at the center, you'll come forward as led by the ushers with your hands cupped to receive the bread into it and then dip it into the cup, returning by the outside aisles to your places of worship and prayer. There are also gluten-free stations offered at either end for those who would receive in this way. The table is prepared and you are invited to come.
Thank you.
thank you for joining us today at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. And I hope you enjoyed our worship service. May the peace, joy, and love of God be with you.